tomorrow, Geraldine Ferraro.
Venture's new store in Mundelein brings grand opening excitement to every Venture store. Soft fleece separates for men and women are 2 for $12, a terrific buy at Venture. So is extra warm sleepwear for ladies, 100% cotton flannel, just $6.99. Plush paws, cozy slippers that are fun to wear, are only $5.99 for ladies, $4.99.
We interrupt our regular program schedule to bring you this ABC News special. The President at the United Nations. Here is correspondent Peter Jennings.
Good morning. This speech of the President's to the UN General Assembly this morning is being regarded throughout the world as one of the most important he's given in a very long time. It is here at the UN this morning. We are told that the President is going to make clear what he wants to talk to the Soviet leader, Mikhail Gorbachev, about when they meet at the summit meeting in Geneva in little less than a month. And we have been encouraged by the administration to look for a new initiative from the President on the question of regional conflicts where the superpowers are involved. President Reagan being escorted by Ali Taymour, the Egyptian chief of protocol at the United Nations, to the center podium to talk to a very changed United Nations in these last 40 years. This is the 40th anniversary, a world body which has gone from 51 nations in 1945 to 159 nations in 1985. And they are all there today, the representatives and heads of government and state from all around the world, who themselves, as is Mrs. Reagan, and on her left, Mrs. Perez de Cuellar, the wife of the Secretary General, President Reagan.
Mr. President, Mr. Secretary General, honored guests and distinguished delegates, thank you for the honor of permitting me to speak on this anniversary for the United Nations. 40 years ago, the world awoke, daring to believe hatred's unyielding grip had finally been broken, daring to believe the torch of peace would be protected in liberty's firm grasp. 40 years ago, the world yearned to dream again innocent dreams, to believe in ideals with innocent trust. Dreams of trust are worthy, but in these 40 years, too many dreams have been shattered, too many promises have been broken, too many lives have been lost. The painful truth is that the use of violence to take, to exercise, and to preserve power remains a persistent reality in much of the world. The vision of the UN Charter to spare succeeding generations this scourge of war remains real. It still stirs our soul and warms our hearts, but it also demands of us a realism that is rock hard, clear-eyed, steady, and sure. A realism that understands the nations of the United Nations are not united. I come before you this morning preoccupied with peace, with ensuring that the differences between some of us not be permitted to degenerate into open conflict, and I come offering for my own country a new commitment, a fresh start. On this UN anniversary, we acknowledge its successes. The decisive action during the Korean War, negotiation of the Non-Proliferation Treaty, strong support for decolonization, and the laudable achievements by the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. Nor must we close our eyes to this organization's disappointments, its failure to deal with real security issues, the total inversion of morality in the infamous Zionism is racism resolution, the politicization of too many agencies, the misuse of too many resources. The UN is a political institution, and politics requires compromise. We recognize that, but let us remember from those first days, one guiding star was supposed to light our path toward the UN vision of peace and progress, the star of freedom. What kind of people will we be 40 years from today? May we answer free people, worthy of freedom, and firm in the conviction that freedom is not the sole prerogative of a chosen few, but the universal right of all God's children. This is the Universal Declaration of Human Rights set forth in 1948. And this is the affirming flame the United States has held high to a watching world. We champion freedom not only because it is practical and beneficial, but because it is morally right and just. Free people whose governments rest upon the consent of the governed do not wage war on their neighbors. Free people, blessed by economic opportunity and protected by laws that respect the dignity of the individual, are not driven toward the domination of others. We readily acknowledge that the United States is far from perfect. Yet we have endeavored earnestly to carry out our responsibilities to the Charter these past 40 years, and we take national pride in our contributions to peace. We take pride in 40 years of helping avert a new world war, and pride in our alliances that protect and preserve us and our friends from aggression. We take pride in the Camp David agreements and our efforts for peace in the Middle East, rooted in resolutions 242 and 338. In supporting Pakistan, target of outside intimidation, in assisting El Salvador's struggle to carry forward its democratic revolution, in answering the appeal of our Caribbean friends in Grenada, in seeing Grenada's representative here today voting the will of its own people. And we take pride in our proposals to reduce the weapons of war. We submit this history as evidence of our sincerity of purpose. But today, it is more important to speak to you about what my country proposes to do in these closing years of the 20th century, to bring about a safer, a more peaceful, a more civilized world. Let us begin with candor, with words that rest on plain and simple facts. The differences between America and the Soviet Union are deep and abiding. The United States is a democratic nation. Here the people rule. We build no walls to keep them in, nor organize any system of police to keep them mute. We occupy no country. The only land abroad we occupy is beneath the graves where our heroes rest. What is called the West is a voluntary association of free nations, all of whom fiercely value their independence and their sovereignty. And as deeply as we cherish our beliefs, we do not seek to compel others to share them. When we enjoy these vast freedoms as we do, it's difficult for us to understand the restrictions of dictatorships which seek to control each institution and every facet of people's lives, the expression of their beliefs, their movements, and their contacts with the outside world. It's difficult for us to understand the ideological premise that force is an acceptable way to expand a political system. We Americans do not accept that any government has the right to command and order the lives of its people, that any nation has an historic right to use force to export its ideology. This belief regarding the nature of man and the limitations of government is at the core of our deep and abiding differences with the Soviet Union. Differences that put us into natural conflict and competition with one another. Now, we would welcome enthusiastically a true competition of ideas, welcome a competition of economic strength and scientific and artistic creativity, and yes, welcome a competition for the goodwill of the world's people. But we cannot accommodate ourselves to the use of force and subversion to consolidate and expand the reach of totalitarianism. When Mr. Gorbachev and I meet in Geneva next month, I look to a fresh start in the relationship of our two nations. We can and should meet in the spirit that we can deal with our differences peacefully. And that is what we expect. The only way to resolve differences is to understand them. We must have candid and complete discussions of where dangers exist and where peace is being disrupted. Make no mistake, our policy of open and vigorous competition rests on a realistic view of the world. And therefore, at Geneva, we must review the reasons for the current level of mistrust. For example, in 1972, the international community negotiated in good faith a ban on biological and toxin weapons. In 1975, we negotiated the Helsinki Accords on human rights and freedoms. And during the decade just passed, the United States and the Soviet Union negotiated several agreements on strategic weapons. And yet we feel it will be necessary at Geneva to discuss with the Soviet Union what we believe are violations of a number of the provisions in all of these agreements. Indeed, this is why it is important that we have this opportunity to air our differences through face-to-face meetings, to let frank talk substitute for anger and tension. The United States has never sought treaties merely to paper over differences. We continue to believe that a nuclear war is one that cannot be won and must never be fought. And that is why we have sought for nearly 10 years, still seek and will discuss in Geneva, radical, equitable, verifiable reductions in these vast arsenals of offensive nuclear weapons. At the beginning of the latest round of the ongoing negotiations in Geneva, the Soviet Union presented a specific proposal involving numerical values. We are studying the Soviet counterproposal carefully. I believe that within their proposal, there are seeds which we should nurture. And in the coming weeks, we will seek to establish a genuine process of give and take. The United States is also seeking to discuss with the Soviet Union in Geneva the vital relationship between offensive and defensive systems, including the possibility of moving toward a more stable and secure world in which defenses play a growing role. The ballistic missile is the most awesome, threatening, and destructive weapon in the history of man. Thus, I welcome the interest of the new Soviet leadership in the reduction of offensive strategic forces. Ultimately, we must remove this menace once and for all from the face of the earth. Until that day, the United States seeks to escape the prison of mutual terror by research and testing that could in time enable us to neutralize the threat of these ballistic missiles and ultimately render them obsolete. How is Moscow threatened if the capitals of other nations are protected? We do not ask that the Soviet leaders, whose country has suffered so much from war, to leave their people defenseless against foreign attack. Why then do they insist that we remain undefended? Who is threatened if Western research and Soviet research, that is itself well advanced, should develop a non-nuclear system which would threaten not human beings, but only ballistic missiles? Surely the world will sleep more secure when these missiles have been rendered useless militarily and politically, when the sword of Damocles that has hung over our planet for too many decades is lifted by Western and Russian scientists working to shield their citizens and one day shut down space as an avenue of weapons of mass destruction. If we're destined by history to compete militarily to keep the peace, then let us compete in systems that defend our societies rather than weapons which can destroy us both and much of God's creation along with us. Some 18 years ago, then Premier Alexei Kosygin was asked about a moratorium on the development of an anti-missile defense system. The official news agency TASS reported that he replied with these words, "I believe that defensive systems which prevent attack are not the cause of the arms race, but can constitute a factor preventing the death of people. Maybe an anti-missile system is more expensive than an offensive system, but it is designed not to kill people, but to preserve human lives." Quoting Alexei Kosygin, "Preserving lives. No peace is more fundamental than that. Great obstacles lie ahead, but they should not deter us. Peace is God's commandment. Peace is the holy shadow cast by men treading on the path of virtue. But just as we all know what peace is, we certainly know what peace is not. Peace based on repression cannot be true peace and is secure only when individuals are free to direct their own governments. Peace based on partition cannot be true peace. Put simply, nothing can justify the continuing and permanent division of the European continent. Walls of partition and distrust must give way to greater communication for an open world. Before leaving for Geneva, I shall make new proposals to achieve this goal. Peace based on mutual fear cannot be true peace, because staking our future on a precarious balance of terror is not good enough. The world needs a balance of safety. And finally, a peace based on averting our eyes from trouble cannot be true peace. The consequences of conflict are every bit as tragic when the destruction is contained within one country. Real peace is what we seek. And that is why today the United States is presenting an initiative that addresses what will be a central issue in Geneva: the issue of regional conflicts in Africa, Asia, and Central America. Our own position is clear. As the oldest nation of the New World, as the first anti-colonial power, the United States rejoiced when decolonization gave birth to so many new nations after World War II. We have always supported the right of the people of each nation to define their own destiny. We have given $300 billion since 1945 to help people of other countries, and we've tried to help friendly governments defend against aggression, subversion, and terror. We have noted with great interest similar expressions of peaceful intent by leaders of the Soviet Union. I am not here to challenge the good faith of what they say, but isn't it important for us to weigh the record as well? In Afghanistan, there are 118,000 Soviet troops prosecuting war against the Afghan people. In Cambodia, 140,000 Soviet-backed Vietnamese soldiers wage a war of occupation. In Ethiopia, 1,700 Soviet advisors are involved in military planning and support operations, along with 2,500 Cuban combat troops. In Angola, 1,200 Soviet military advisors involved in planning and supervising combat operations, along with 35,000 Cuban troops. In Nicaragua, some 8,000 Soviet bloc and Cuban personnel, including about 3,500 military and secret police personnel. All of these conflicts, some of them underway for a decade, originate in local disputes, but they share a common characteristic. They are the consequence of an ideology imposed from without, dividing nations and creating regimes that are, almost from the day they take power, at war with their own people. And in each case, Marxism-Leninism's war with the people becomes war with their neighbors. These wars are exacting a staggering human toll and threaten to spill across national boundaries and trigger dangerous confrontations. Where is it more appropriate than right here at the United Nations to call attention to Article 2 of our Charter, which instructs members to refrain, quote, from the use or threat or use of force against the territorial integrity or political independence of any state, end quote. During the past decade, these wars played a large role in building suspicions and tensions in my country over the purpose of Soviet policy. This gives us an extra reason to address them seriously today. Last year, I proposed from this podium that the United States and Soviet Union hold discussions on some of these issues, and we have done so. But I believe these problems need more than talk. For that reason, we are proposing and are fully committed to support a regional peace process that seeks progress on three levels. First, we believe the starting point must be a process of negotiation among the warring parties in each country I've mentioned, which, in the case of Afghanistan, includes the Soviet Union. The form of these talks may and should vary, but negotiations and an improvement of internal political conditions are essential to achieving an end to violence, the withdrawal of foreign troops, and national reconciliation. There is a second level, Once negotiations take hold and the parties directly involved are making real progress, representatives of the United States and the Soviet Union should sit down together. It is not for us to impose any solutions in this separate set of talks. Such solutions would not last. But the issue we should address is how best to support the ongoing talks among the warring parties. In some cases, it might well be appropriate to consider guarantees for any agreements already reached. But in every case, the primary task is to promote this goal: verified elimination of the foreign military presence and restraint on the flow of outside arms. And finally, if these first two steps are successful, we could move on to the third: welcoming each country back into the world economy so its citizens can share in the dynamic growth that other developing countries, countries that are at peace, enjoy. Despite past differences with these regimes, the United States would respond generously to their democratic reconciliation with their own people, their respect for human rights, and their return to the family of free nations. Of course, until such time as these negotiations result in definitive progress, America's support for struggling democratic resistance forces must not and shall not cease. This plan is bold, it is realistic. It is not a substitute for existing peacemaking efforts, it complements them. We're not trying to solve every conflict in every region of the globe, and we recognize that each conflict has its own character. Naturally, other regional problems will require different approaches. But we believe that the recurrent pattern of conflict that we see in these five cases ought to be broken as soon as possible. We must begin somewhere. So let us begin where there is great need and great hope. This will be a clear step forward to help people choose their future more freely. Moreover, this is an extraordinary opportunity for the Soviet side to make a contribution to regional peace, which in turn can promote future dialogue and negotiations on other critical issues. With hard work and imagination, there is no limit to what, working together, our nations can achieve. Gaining a peaceful resolution of these conflicts will open whole new vistas of peace and progress. The discovery that the promise of the future lies not in measures of military defense or the control of weapons, but in the expansion of individual freedom and human rights. Only when the human spirit can worship, create, and build, only when people are given a personal stake in determining their own destiny and benefiting from their own risks, do societies become prosperous, progressive, dynamic, and free. We need only open our eyes to the economic evidence all around us. Nations that deny their people opportunity in Eastern Europe, Indochina, Southern Africa, and Latin America, without exception, are dropping further behind in the race for the future. But where we see enlightened leaders who understand that economic freedom and personal incentive are key to development, we see economies striding forward. Singapore, Taiwan, South Korea, India, Botswana, and China. These are among the current and emerging success stories because they have the courage to give economic incentives a chance. Let us all heed the simple eloquence in Andrei Sakharov's Nobel Peace Prize message: international trust, mutual understanding, disarmament, and international security are inconceivable without an open society with freedom of information, freedom of conscience, the right to publish, and the right to travel and choose the country in which one wishes to live. At the core, this is an eternal truth. Freedom works. That is the promise of the open world and awaits only our collective grasp. 40 years ago, hope came alive again for a world that hungered for hope. I believe fervently that hope is still alive. The United States has spoken with candor and conviction today, But that does not lessen these strong feelings held by every American. It's in the nature of Americans to hate war and its destructiveness. We would rather wage our struggle to rebuild and renew, not to tear down. We would rather fight against hunger, disease, and catastrophe. We would rather engage our adversaries in the battle of ideals and ideas for the future. These principles emerge from the innate openness and good character of our people, and from our long struggle and sacrifice for our liberties and the liberties of others. Americans always yearn for peace. They have a passion for life. They carry in their hearts a deep capacity for reconciliation. Last year at this General Assembly, I indicated there was every reason for the United States and the Soviet Union to shorten the distance between us. In Geneva, the first meeting between our heads of government in more than 6 years, Mr. Gorbachev and I will have that opportunity. So yes, let us go to Geneva with both sides committed to dialogue. Let both sides go committed to a world with fewer nuclear weapons, and someday with none. Let both sides go committed to walk together on a safer path into the 21st century and to lay the foundation for enduring peace. It is time indeed to do more than just talk of a better world. It is time to act, and we will act when nations cease to try to impose their ways upon others. And we will act when they realize that we, for whom the achievement of freedom has come dear, will do what we must to preserve it from assault. America is committed to the world because so much of the world is inside America. After all, only a few miles from this very room is our Statue of Liberty, past which life began anew for millions, where the peoples from nearly every country in this hall joined to build these United States. The blood of each nation courses through the American vein and feeds the spirit that compels us to involve ourselves in the fate of this good earth. It is the same spirit that warms our heart in concern to help ease the desperate hunger that grips proud people on the African continent. It is the internationalist spirit that came together last month when our neighbor Mexico was struck suddenly by an earthquake. Even as the Mexican nation moved vigorously into action, there were heartwarming offers by other nations, offering to help and glimpses of people working together without concern for national self-interest or gain. And if there was any meaning to salvage out of that tragedy, it was found one day in a huge mound of rubble that was once the Juarez Hospital in Mexico City. A week after that terrible event, and as another day of despair unfolded, a team of workers heard a faint sound coming from somewhere in the heart of the crushed concrete. Hoping beyond hope, they quickly burrowed toward it. And as the late afternoon light faded, and racing against time, they found what they had heard. And the first of three baby girls, newborn infants, emerged to the safety of the rescue team. And let me tell you the scene through the eyes of one who was there. Everyone was so quiet when they lowered that little baby down in a basket covered with blankets. The baby didn't make a sound either. But the minute they put her in the Red Cross ambulance, everybody just got up and cheered. Well, amidst all that hopelessness and debris came a timely and timeless lesson for us all. We witnessed the miracle of life. It is on this that I believe our nations can make a renewed commitment. The miracle of life is given by one greater than ourselves. But once given, each life is ours to nurture and preserve, to foster not only for today's world, but for a better one to come. There is no purpose more noble than for us to sustain and celebrate life in a turbulent world. And that is what we must do now. We have no higher duty, no greater cause as humans. Life and the preservation of freedom to live it in dignity is what we are on this earth to do. Everything we work to achieve must seek that end so that someday our prime ministers, our premiers, our presidents, and our general secretaries will talk not of war and peace, but only of peace. We've had 40 years to begin. Let us not waste one more moment to give back to the world all that we can in return for this miracle of life. Thank you all. God bless you all.
As you look at the representatives from the Soviet Union, Edward Shevardnadze, the new foreign minister, and Oleg Kalinowski, the permanent representative, the ambassador to the United Nations, President Reagan concludes his 40th anniversary memorial speech, you might call it, on the 40th anniversary of the United Nations. The president and the other heads of state and government, with the exception of the Soviet leader, Mr. Gorbachev, who was not coming to the General Assembly, coming here to New York this week to lay out for the General Assembly and in the contest for international public opinion their concern about the state of the world 40 years after this world body was founded. And the president speaking for about 30 minutes on how he sees the state of competition, essentially, between the United States and the Soviet Union, and now being thanked by the Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Pérez de Cuellar. And as the president is taken away by the Chief of Protocol, Eliakim Ali Temur, he will be followed to the podium by other heads of state and government who have been speaking all week. Among the other people to talk today are India, China, and Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher of Great Britain. It is a very strong and very stirring speech in the contest for international public opinion, which precedes the meeting that President Reagan is going to have with Mr. Gorbachev in Geneva in just about a month. And a number of my colleagues are now standing by to assess it from their various perspectives. ABC's Lou Chiaffi covers the United Nations for us. Lou, I couldn't help but note throughout this that the United Nations, for everything that the president said, is a pretty cynical place. How will this speech go down?
Well, I think the delegates to this General Assembly were most interested to hear what the president had to say about possible cooperation with the Soviet Union on regional conflicts. One of the complaints here at the UN has always been the fact that the regional arguments have gotten worse because of the conflict between the United States and the Soviet Union. This, of course, is viewed at the Security Council itself, where solutions are proposed, and however, either the Soviet Union or the United States would veto it. If this means that the Soviet Union and the United States are going to agree to help work out these problems, this is good news for the General Assembly. And I find it fascinating, Peter, that in the last 2 weeks before the president's speech, the Soviet diplomats here at the United Nations have been pointing out to anyone who listen that there are at least one area in the world where there is a mutuality of interest, and they're pointing to Beirut and its terrorism. For the first time, the Soviets have been the target of terrorism. The United States, of course, for a long time has been, and they're asking the question, isn't there a possibility of cooperation there? That would be a good start.
Lou, when Americans listen to the words of the president, even if they disagree with him on particular issues, I think they're very moved by the president's view and image of America in the world. The diplomats at the United Nations ever get moved, or do they just look at it hard and cold on paper?
They're realists here. They're pragmatists here. They listen to the words, and they listen to the grammar and all the rest, but what they're looking is, what does the president really mean? Is he really meaning to do what he says he's going to do? They're rather pessimistic here about the American attitude towards the United Nations in general. They're not so sure that the United States supports the UN as much as it does. One of the complaints here among the organizers of this 40th anniversary celebration was the fact that this was supposed to be a year in which all the countries would get together and, if you will, revitalize the UN. And what has happened is the Soviet Union and the United States scheduled a meeting in Geneva in November during the session, which to many people here cut the ground out from the importance of this 40th anniversary celebration.
Lou, thank you very much. ABC's White House correspondent Sam Donaldson is there with you. Sam, in the run-up to Geneva, virtually all of the attention until now has been on arms control. The president has attempted to move the focus away today to regional crises. What is the White House's aim here?
Well, Peter, as you heard, this is a very tough speech the president gave on the Soviets. He says he wants a new start at Geneva, but certainly not to let bygones be bygones. And one of our main complaints about Moscow is the fact that they are supporting so many repressive acts around the world, the nations the president mentioned. So he wants to elevate this to a point of great concern. But right behind that, Peter, is something that has to do with what you said right after the speech, and that is the effort to seize the spotlight for world public relations. Gorbachev stole a march on the administration a few weeks ago by announcing this 50% reduction in nuclear weapons systems plan. And flawed though it may be, it sort of captured the attention of people. Now the president has tried to announce a peace initiative for these regional conflicts. And flawed though it may be, because he proposes negotiations, and I suppose if the Soviets had wanted to negotiate away their interest in these conflicts, they might have started some time ago, it will also, they hope, at the White House, capture the attention of the world.
Sam, the president, of course, did mention arms control negotiations. He said that we were studying very carefully and saw seeds in Mr. Gorbachev's 50% proposal. Is there any hint in the speech for you about the strategic defense initiative which the Soviets would like to eliminate?
No, there's no hint here. We ask the question every day, are you going to put SDI, or the so-called Star Wars Initiative, on the table in Geneva to negotiate? And always the answer comes back, no negotiations on research and testing of SDI components. But the president has said repeatedly that before we deploy SDI, there will be negotiations with the Soviets. Now, that's what they say, Peter. What are they going to do at Geneva? Let you and I go there and find out.
Okay, Sam, thanks very much. ABC's John McQuethy is standing by in Washington now. John says, the president says this is a bold new proposal for progress on negotiations among the warring parties and individual countries in United States and Soviet involvement. How does it look to the professionals, realistically?
Well, for years, Peter, the United States and the Soviet Union have been very careful about dealing with regional conflicts, not to get too deeply involved in terms of having the superpowers do the negotiating, to let the warring factions do that. What the president is saying in this speech is, perhaps the superpowers will get a tiny bit more involved, but he's very careful to say, let the warring factions do it first, and then if they can finally make some agreement, then the superpowers will come in and help to make the agreement stick.
Okay, John, give us an example. The president has talked about Afghanistan, about Ethiopia, about Central America, about Cambodia, about Southern Africa. Give us a hint of where this might begin.
Well, it could begin in any one of the forums. In Afghanistan, for example, that's one place the Reagan administration would very much like to see it begin, but it's not a place that the Soviet Union would probably be terribly interested in. In Central America, the Reagan administration has been pushing the Nicaraguan regime there. That is probably an area that the Soviets would most like to see it happen. Again, the president has very carefully left the initiative up to the warring factions, and the warring factions have very little desire to get together on it.
John, the other thing the president did say was that until such time as these negotiations he's referring to result in definitive progress, America's support for struggling democratic resistance forces will continue. So that means continued support for the Contra forces in Nicaragua, for the anti-government forces in Angola, Afghanistan?
That means that the Reagan administration will continue providing covert and some overt aid to a number of resistance factions. That's true.
John, our professional diplomats in Washington now have to deal with this. Where did this idea emerge? Is it a White House idea, or has it come from the professional diplomats at the State Department?
I think it has come from a need by the Reagan administration to find a broader way to take some of the focus off of the arms control issue and to focus on some of the other things that they feel are perhaps putting unfair pressure on the arms control issue.
Okay, John, thank you very much. Sam Donaldson and Lucci Yaffe. That is the president's speech on the 40th anniversary of the United Nations. And as it percolates down and through the international community throughout the rest of the day, we shall continue to gather reaction to it. Is it stirring? Is it realistic? Will it fly? What will the Soviet reaction be to it? And we will have a full report on all that reaction and a reprise of the president's speech during World News Tonight. I'm Peter Jennings in New York. Thank you for joining us.
This has been an ABC News special. We now resume our regular program schedule after this from our local stations.
It was all St. Louis in Game 4 of the World Series. With their home run bats blazing, the Cards gave their ace John Tudor what he needed, a nifty three-run cushion. He went on to shut out the Royals. St. Louis would flip to win it all, and it can happen in Game 5 tonight on ABC Sports.
Twice again, we have over 10,000 books to choose from. For example, James Michener's new bestseller, Texas, is only $12.99. That's more than 40% off. And travel the globe with the Hammond World Atlas, priced at only $23.97. Crown's one place you can't judge a book by its cover, price. So remember, if you paid full price, you didn't buy it at Crown Books.
The new Drury Lane in Oak Brook Terrace is theater. It's fine dining in three elegant atmospheres. It's entertainment and it's business with over 13,000 square feet of banquet, meeting, convention, and exhibition space. The Drury Lane Oak Brook Terrace is exciting, intimate, exotic, and it's waiting for you. Experience the flair of Drury Lane. Call 530-8300 for information.
Tulips from Holland, lilies from France, orchids from Hawaii. Ronsley, probably the finest florist in the world.
Minutes. Caller, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, Oprah. My name is Lisa Slear. And about 2 months ago, I won $2,700, and it was a quick pick.